So, good morning to everyone. I assume you had a short night, but I hope you had a good sleep. I heard that some of our guests just directly went to the airport in the morning. So good to have you here. So we would like, as I mentioned yesterday, to look more deep in all your work, what you did, our two winners. And I'm very glad to have you here, Natalie, as a jury member, and also Dominic as a jury member and the first newcomer winner for this talk this morning. And of course, again, congratulations. And it's so wonderful to have you here also for the talk to learn more about you and your work. Thank you. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for coming out. So we're going to get right into this, hoping today that we can have a nice, intimate conversation about exactly what it takes to do the work and be in the situations that Kiana and Valentin have so successfully done and the stories they've told. I want to begin by reading a quote that we read, if anybody was at the press conference yesterday. And this is a big shout out to Maggie Stieber, who spotted the quote that was on the wall behind as Valentin and Kiana were speaking. But it's by René Bury, and it says, "What counts is putting the intensity that you yourself have experienced into the picture. Otherwise, it is just a document." And I think that that really sets the tone for what we're hoping to do today and hoping to some of the points that we're trying to emphasize. What we're going to be exploring a little bit is the value of representation in storytelling and how that Kiana and Valentin have really delved deeply into that to help communicate in the stories they're finding and telling. And we're going to explore a little bit of subjectivity and what exactly that means when you are exploring issues of your own identity and how that plays into your work. And then we are also going to touch on the support system that is required in order to really succeed. I don't think anybody does this alone. I think that it is really an effort, and finding your voice is something that is very important, but is also of a collaborative experience. And it takes others sometimes to push you to help you find that voice. So we are going to get started now with Kiana. I believe there is a video that we're going to watch with your winning series for the Loba Award. So, Kiana, I'm hoping that we can start by you just telling us a little bit about what inspired you to first pick up a camera.
I was a teenager when I moved to Canada, and I didn't speak much English. So in school, I was taking I had enough credit. I was taking all the art classes and English, and photography felt right because I didn't have to speak in English. So that was really, in short, that really became a tool for me to connect with my peers and the environment that I was placed in.
And how do you think in your first explorations and some of the themes that you were looking at when once you were photographing, how did your own identity and experience play a role into your curiosity of what you were looking for?
It was very natural by that I turned my camera onto things that was very close to me. When I was like first year of university, I photographed my own family. Then I went on one summer I was away. I went back to Iran, and I had reached by that point, I was kind of like in between places. In Canada, I was never Canadian. In Iran, I was not Iranian. So I was like one foot in, one foot out. And then witnessing my own friends and how they were doing things that I was doing in Canada at the same time, I naturally started photographing my own friends. And then I went back to Canada and I received a lot of good feedback. Everybody loved seeing those images. At the time, it was very unique because it was really the first images of modern youth coming out. This is 2010. So I continued and I expanded it. Then I went back to Iran and started photographing the Iranian youth, which is actually how I landed in Afghanistan as well. It was the youth work that I did. Then later for my school thesis project, I was 16 when I moved out of Iran. I went and photographed four 17-year-old girls in Iran before they left. And then right after university, I got a grant to follow up with them around the world. So I went to Australia, to US and Canada, and I photographed them in their new environment. Again, it was a personal experience that I was just re-photographing is not the right word. So that really how, and then eventually by the end of that period, I walked away with a body of work about youth in Iran. And I got the first assignment to go and do a story on youth in Afghanistan, and that's how I landed there.
That's wonderful. And do you think that that experience of your own migration process helped you better connect with the subjects that you were covering?
I think when I started doing that, it was, looking back at the time, I didn't really feel it, but it was tough. It was hard to put a teenager who doesn't speak the language in a new environment. I think I started photographing them to see how other people deal with it. I don't think I was, at that time, I was mature enough and old enough to use that as like a way to connect. Later on, I did. I did other stories about migration, and then I knew how to make it work. But at the time, it was really personal curiosity to see how other girls go through this.
So it was almost the camera became your tool of understanding the world, right? Like how you processed what you were seeing and experiencing yourself at the same time.
Absolutely, yeah.
That's wonderful. So you have selected a few images here that we, from your body of work, which spans about in women in Afghanistan, spans about 8 years, is that correct?
Yeah, 8 years. This is Lieutenant Zala at her the post she had in eastern Afghanistan, very, very conservative region. This is several years before the fall, so it's important, but she was never accepted by her male peers, so there was a lot of judgment about her. Should we come back to this?
No, I think, okay. I think that this is a really interesting image, and you spoke a little bit about this yesterday, but would love for you to explain to us exactly what this situation was that you were photographing, and I think oftentimes as photographers, you get pulled in many different directions. There's an expectation of what you should be getting out of a story, and that doesn't sometimes match. Mm-hmm. Would love to hear a little bit about that.
This is inside Herat prison, female prison. I had gone in with the intention of photographing women who have been incarcerated for murdering their husbands to get out of abuse and domestic violence. And I think it's a story that to this day like shattered all the stereotype for me myself. Because when you go into a space like prison, you go in with you have some ideas of what a prison is, and this definitely didn't match that. It was a house that had turned into a prison. There were walls with barbed wire, and then everything else was really like a dormitory. And I talked about this yesterday, but one of the challenges was throughout. So we did three. I did three trips and 15 days, and as I was like sending images to my editors, they kept saying, "But we need to see this as prison." And I was like, "Well, this is it. This is what a prison looked like." So it was quite challenging. But then eventually, I think with the repetition of like showing like there is no more to photograph, right? They also accepted and they realized the story is about something else. Really, the story is about how these women feel more free and more happy inside the prison than the outside world. And I, after the fall, this metaphor came to me when I was like recording something, that. When the fall happened, they opened, the day before Herat fell, the prison guards opened the doors of the prison to let all the women out, not realizing they're actually, it's not liberating for them. They put them into a larger prison called Afghanistan.
That, I can imagine that that was a really difficult conversation to have. I don't know, you know, just being in the role of an editor and speaking with photographers, I know that not everybody is comfortable with, not necessarily correcting, but with explaining the actual situation versus like what is imagined and expected. How did you go about having that conversation? Was that hard at all for you? Or
I think this was my first assignment for the New York Times Magazine. So I was a little insecure. So for me, it was like gently pushing back. It was not easy. But it was always respectful. But I was joking this morning between us that I think having been in a place like in Afghanistan for so long and having worked there, I do have the privilege of now being able to like push back. I'm a little dictator when it comes to shooting my stories now. It's like, this is it.
But that's so important, I think, just also to about your confidence and the intention there in making sure that the story is told correctly and the story is told well, right? And I think that that's the valuable perspective that you bring to an assignment in this situation, right? Otherwise, it would have been a different story had you not been involved.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Also, the access as well. You were speaking in our little conversation about the access to the prison. You didn't go with anybody, right?
No.
So how did that work?
So I speak the language, and so I was solo. I didn't have anyone with me, no interpreter. So I was able to like go in and hang out all day long. I even slept over one night. The first day or two, they had a guard with me, but then they realized it's fine. So I don't think I'm sorry to say that, but if you had placed a white person who didn't speak the language, maybe like it's more language and like the color, but like into that space, it would have been as smoothly, like you could sneak between spaces. And so that definitely, a lot of the stories that I've worked on, the language has really helped.
And so they accepted you much faster?
Yeah. Okay. Much, much faster. Like by the first few days, people were reluctant to talk. So I remember first day specifically, I didn't take a single frame. It was a lot of chatting, interviewing, and then second day, and then more and more people came forward with their stories. Right. By the end of it, I had to turn people away because I just didn't have time to do it again. So time definitely gives time, gives trust, trust gives access and intimacy. And I do have to give credit to the magazine for giving me that much time and space, because it's a luxury these days to have that much time.
Yeah, absolutely. It's lucky to have that ability to connect.
There's not a lot of like a big story behind it. It's just that inside a classroom in north east of Afghanistan, a region where people are very open-minded. And I remember this is when the body contact between men and women and young teenagers is very rare. When this happened, I was kind of like, wow. But it's beautiful. You don't see this in Afghanistan. You do see it if you're inside people's homes, but you don't see this getting captured. Yeah.
I think that that's what's really wonderful about your images. There's a surprising quality to each one, right? Like in the way it's not exactly how you expect to see a scene or how we've seen it before. but it's the surprising elements that really draw you in.
This is a funeral after a triple explosion, suicide attack in Kabul. It was inside a basement of the mosque as we were trying to tell the story. And this is not necessarily as a single photograph, but I love the what it stands for. Hafiza has got four sons that each joined different side of the war. And this was shot before the fall. And she has a little wound, open wound here, which doctor believe it's caused by grief. And then I shot this, and then after in the discussion with the team that was putting the story together, it came out as like, it's kind of like a symbol for Afghanistan, a country with open wounds that is struggling to heal. What I do encourage people to do is, we did a follow-up story with Hafiza a year later after Taliban came into power, and we went to the village and met with the son, including the Talib son, to see how the family has come together or not to come together. But for you guys to find out.
Yeah. Okay, well, thank you so much, Kiana.
Thank you.
Now we're going to go have a little conversation with Valentin. Congratulations on the Newcomer Award. Let's start by watching some of your winning series. So, Valentin, starting at the same point, actually, what was it that first inspired you to pick up a camera?
I guess there really was not really a point when a camera was not around. So, well, my father always used to take pictures, so I'm very accustomed to having a camera laying at the table all the time. But I, well, and when I started to work on telling stories in some way, I really had to draw a line between the way my father approaches it and I do. So my first approach was to write. I was like in the student newspaper and did a lot of that. And then after school, I eventually had a first exhibition of my photography, because I had always been doing it on the side. And then there was a photographer in Regensburg, in my hometown, that thought it was good, and then at some point we just got together and I was his new assistant. And he really, well, he sensibilized me for the idea of also being able to tell my stories not only through text but also through photography. And well, I've been doing it with his help also ever since, and I guess we'll be talking about that later when it comes to guidance. And since 2019 I'm now studying documentary photography and photojournalism in Hanover. Okay, so shortly before the corona thing went down. Yeah.
So maybe walk us through, right, January 2020. I think that everybody had a very different expectation of what that year was going to look like for them.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
as someone, you know, beginning university, what happened like in those first few months for you?
Yeah, well, it was very strange, really, because like in February 2020, I had the first holiday in school, in university, and I thought that this was my great big chance to finally do a big project, and I went to Argentina to a little village that I was on a student exchange when I was 16, and I photographed my friends over there that like have been living there, of course, ever since. And it kind of was a story about youth in isolation, because the village was 3 hours away from the next village, so getting there, getting to outside points of the village was really, really hard to do. And without really knowing it yet, I had been working on a project that kind of deals at least with the subjective feeling of youth in times of Corona already. So it was teenagers in isolation, and then I returned. And well, like a few days after my flight back to Hanover, the university was closed. So that was really when Corona came up for me. And I took the first months of Corona to kind of find some way to find some solid ground again, because taking pictures always for me means a very involved state of chaos in the head. And I really have to come back to myself afterwards. And I enjoyed the time of Corona at first. It was like a very intense time with my girlfriend at the time. We kind of grew together in a kind of symbiosis, and then at some point that broke. And but in between, I started taking pictures of the only thing I could take pictures of, which was the people living in my flat share, like many people did. So many people studying with me at university also did the very same thing, taking pictures of their colleagues and friends and so on. And then at some point I got a call from Die Zeit, from Amelie sitting over there, who set me on the task to make the approach a little wider and try to capture what it feels like to grow up in times of Corona in Germany in general by taking pictures of my friends. And that was really when I realized that my very subjective and personal approach to the story, for me as one of the youngest photographers in German business at the time, was something relevant to tell. So that really gave me the legitimation and the trust in the whole work that it is very, very important and necessary that I tell this story from my personal perspective. Yeah.
I can imagine that was, having studied photojournalism, I can imagine that was some contradictory feelings, right? As you're deciding to take on a more personal involvement into the story.
Yeah, we were talking about it earlier. The first thing you do in university is try to find a topic that's close to yourself. So the first thing I really did at university was taking pictures of my best friend, who's now in the car in the exhibition, and also taking pictures of my parents. And I think approaching personal topics was also, well, always very close to me, because like keeping diary and so on is something that is incredibly important for me to organize myself and my head and everything that's happening around me. And the thing you might be mentioning right now is the personal approach in the sense of subjectivity, because that, of course, is something that studying photojournalism in Hanover, of course, sometimes has some problems with. So very, very early in the studies, before Christoph Bangert, for example, a real hardcore war photographer, became a professor, I had a very intense conversation also with another professor who did her thesis on the documentary power of photography and if there is such a thing as objectivity. And that really set me on a photographic existential crisis, you might say, because it, of course, is not... It's not a new thing. I'm not reinventing the wheel or something. People have been staging their friends and their families since the 70s or even before, and maybe only since the 70s you're talking about it. But the thing is that the realization that in the moment that I enter a room, there is no more objectivity involved, because I, of course, through my sheer presence, manipulate the room, and then through my photographic observation, I only depict a very, very small part of the reality that's happening in front of me. So I will always be selecting what seems right to me. That set me on the question, okay, what am I doing here? So being the fly on the wall, being an objective photojournalist, it is something that I had a great interest in, and it was the thing I wanted to do when I came to Hanover. There was like people like Kai Löffelbein that inspired me a lot, and then at some point it started to change. So I wanted to tell stories from my personal point of view, in the knowledge that that's the only stance I can take. Yeah.
Maybe you can walk us through a few of the images and your approach. And I think one of the things that you've mentioned is how personal these images are and how you really use them as a tool to explore your own feelings about going through the pandemic and the coronavirus. So I'm very curious to hear a little bit more about how these pictures were made and how you did put in your own, you know, personal feelings into them.
Okay, we start with this one.
Yeah.
This is actually in my flat chair in the kitchen. So that's my flatmate at the time and her boyfriend. And this is one thing when, like, it was a really incredible evening because she wanted to go to France to do an au pair. And then she, at the same day, got the call that she will be studying medicine in Rostock, so close to the city. And she was my very, very important person of relation when I moved into that flat chair, because it was like right after my girlfriend broke up with me and I was really in a bad state of mind. And then I really connected very strongly to her and her boyfriend also, and it was a very important thing. And then at the day she got the call that she will go to Rostock instead of going to France, and for me it was really frustrating because I knew she will be staying in Germany, but she still will be moving out. And I felt very disconnected to the whole scene. And normally when I feel connected to a scene, I involve myself. And this was something that felt kind of strange to me. So I was at the other side of the room. I was sitting next to the door. We have no door in the kitchen. We have only got a washing machine. And I was leaning towards the washing machine and taking pictures. And then at some point, my other flatmate came in, and we weren't expecting him to be here. And they just blew up. In one moment, everything was really strange because we thought we were this isolated group of only three people, and then suddenly there was a fourth person, and this intruder, entering in, it was something that I felt connected to, in some way, and that's.
I think that comes across in the image, definitely.
That's good. that's one of my favorite pictures. Well, the thing is, I took pictures of people I knew very well. So, for example, like my flatmates, and he's someone I did not know that very well, but still we felt a strong connection at the moment we met, and we had an appointment to photograph him mowing the lawn of his mother's house, and so when we went to the lawn, we had to pass through the kitchen, and his mother was still sitting there because it was after breakfast, and I knew that I really wanted to do a picture of him and his mother. And it often the thing with my approach is that the approach comes with before the words to talk about it, which is some problem, you might say. And the thing with this was that I felt strongly connected also to the mother. I've been thinking about it a lot. She at least got the same hairstyle, and also it feels very familiar. And I knew I needed to take a picture of them too. So I asked them if I could, and they said yes. And the thing is that I sense I often like have a strong sentiment about things happening between the lines people are saying. I often like feel energy in a room, and that's the thing. I sense things, and that's the thing you do with photography. You will always have your own perception, and you will always find your own key of putting your perception in the scene you're photographing, and find a way to visualize it. And in that way, you stress it. So you find your perception, you have some kind of idea of what it looks like in a prison, for example, or what it looks like to have a conversation with your mother, and you emphasize this, you stress it. And you choose your frame, you choose the topic that you need to take a picture to phrase and emphasize your own reflection of the thing you're seeing. And the thing is, with the realization I had before, that I can only be subjective, I let myself roam free without really knowing it. It felt very, very natural to be involved in the scene because they knew I was there and we were talking about the picture I was going to take and so on, and I was talking about my relationship to my mother as well. So it's like it's a very intimate scene that's happening in the moment. I'm there and talking with the people and taking pictures of them, and to stress the energy between them that I saw, and I probably only saw it because I know the energy between me and my mother. So that's my own perception of it that comes now in that. I wanted to stress it, so I asked him to look at his mother, I asked the mother to look at her newspaper, and that's when it all came together. And to me still, it is the picture that for me is incredibly important in telling the story. I recently realized there's not a single father in the whole story. I didn't take a picture of any father. It's only mothers. And that's something that for me, of course, it's frightening to realize that. And sometimes your own perception of that, because not photographing a father, that was not a conscious decision. Mm-hmm. That simply just happened. And at some point I was finished and I looked at it, there's not a single man inside of it. And sometimes your manipulation of the story you are telling is very subconscious, like me not photographing a father. And sometimes your manipulation is more conscious, like me photographing the mother I went the way I did. So that's the way I approach it. And there's very different, of course, ways of using manipulation to get close to it, and sometimes I don't at all. So if you go to the next picture, that's something I simply was attending the whole party, and I was waiting at the back of the table, and I didn't really know what I was waiting for, but I pushed the trigger in the right moment, and then when I was back at my desk and looking at the picture, and I saw it, and I saw this guy, it was the only time last year that I was crying out of joy. And really, I was crying. I had tears in my eyes because I recognized myself in it. And that's something that happened by accident. And sometimes it does happen by accident, and sometimes it's something I do very, very consciously. And I'm incredibly happy and also kind of proud that photography is something I can use in that way to communicate. It's great, yeah.
Well, you've developed a very strong body of work as a result, and I think that something that really... as an editor, or the conversations that we were having in the newsroom at the time of the pandemic, there was a reoccurring concern for how this pandemic was going to be impacting the youth, a whole generation, and seeing this series really, shed light on what that experience was like, and I think it really helped show that and in a very unique way that we were not already seeing before, that intimacy and that being able to really be inside that experience from someone who's going through it, I think was very unique and not something really that was missing more broadly, right? We saw the empty streets, we saw the closed down cities, but this was the reality for many people.
Yeah.
And that's interesting as well, what you just said, this intimacy. There's one thing to document, same with the quote as well, to document and just to document. And there's another aspect to get close enough that there's intensity and a feeling between the subjects, between the photographer and the subjects. One thing I just wanted to say, while we're judging the different works, both of you had, and we'll be talking about that with the support system, incredible, incredible sequencing of images. I mean, the way the story started and ended and everything in between, it was so well thought through that I really just wanted to say, seeing the images again, both of you, that it was incredible how the stories were kind of presented. This one thing to take all the photographs, but another to really refine and define each moment, each picture in a sequence that makes sense. And again, seeing them both of you, it just, that was one of the things I remember, was it was just so solid of the thought from the beginning to the end, before we go into
that's
the next aspect. But I just wanted to say that again, seeing that
Can
here.
I make a note on that? I do have to give credit to Sarah Lynn, because she was heavily involved in editing that body of work. I turned in, again, I said this last night, so I won't repeat myself, but I thought my work is not suitable for this. She was the one who pushed me, and I gave her 300 photos. She came back with like 35, and so she's heavily involved. It's her eyes, yeah. So credit to her.
I mean, I think that's Dom is totally right, there were so many strong projects that we saw, but one of the way that you really rise, right, both of your projects rose above the others, was that really strong series and sequencing and being very disciplined in not allowing the repetition or redundancy. Each image really had intention in communicating a broader part of the story. And I think it's so true that that's where the support system comes into play. And sometimes I think as photographers, it can be very challenging to look at your own body of work and not, again, for all the reasons that you're saying, that you become attached to an image because of your own history and connection to it, it can be really challenging to go and make a selection that is more objective, right? That is removed from the 5 hours that it took you to make that image versus the reality of what it's actually communicating. So maybe how did that relationship begin? And I also love that the, you know, how you see yourself, right? You did not see yourself as even potentially entering the LOBA, yet you did, and here you are now. And I think that's just a good reminder for everybody, right? It is important to put yourself out there. It's important to enter these contests, and it is not, it's not about winning, right? I think that there's actually a lot to be learned in the process of answering the, of filling out the application, of answering, right? It forces you to be a little bit more focused about what exactly is your intention in producing this work and stepping back to create, right, a series. And what has that experience been like for both of you, and who has kind of helped push you to do that?
So I have always been, of course, very thankful to have a father with photography always like at my hand. And then there was the mentor I just mentioned, who always has been a big guiding light. And then they're also like working on this project in particular. It of course was great to have people from a newspaper working with me on it, and like emphasizing my whole story. And that was very thankful, of course. And there's like always people that understand, and there's always people that don't understand. And I have been very lucky in the last years to have people that kind of helped me grow in my photography. Yeah, that isn't even necessarily always only like compliments and go for it and do it that way, but it's also of course the conflicts that also bring you further. So the way that I now talk about subjectivity and objectivity and truth and documentary, or if it is possible or not, that's all based on a very, very horrible conversation I had with my professor just a few weeks ago that set me on my second photographic existential crisis. Because like, especially in journalistic contexts, of course, it's very important to talk about a more or less unusual approach to photography, because it often, of course, has like a more illustrative character. And that's something that some people working in photojournalism understand, some people working outside of photojournalism understand, and then there's people working in fields that don't understand it, or that have colleagues that do understand it, and it's always very, well, at the moment it's very complicated. I'm trying to navigate through it, but it's hard.
Dom, I feel like you have some good experience in that you were the LOBA newcomer winner in 2009.
Yeah.
Is that correct? And I'm curious how that experience was for you, right? Kind of emerging photographically, hearing all these different opinions, and how do you kind of distill the noise in it?
Well, I think one of those things as well that both of you are pointing out, that identifying who is that person that you're really listening to, because there's a lot of voices that are coming to you, giving their thoughts and their constructive criticism, but then identifying maybe who the main person might be, or the two main people that are the ones that are going to help you move the project forward. And I had a professor like that as well that really helped me move forward in the different stories I was doing, and gave me confidence, this is what I'm going to do, and believed in that. Even the first mentors I had who didn't give me the choice to be a photographer and just told me I'm going to be a photographer, and then I'm starting tomorrow at the local newspaper. Like, the best thing to have, 20-year-old, is not to have options and just somebody tell you what to do. And luckily he was right, so it fit. So having these mentors or these guides, be it in the academic world, but also in the professional world, where I was in East Timor doing story, and my teachers were the local journalists who were helping me navigate that space and learn how to connect with people in a way that I couldn't have learned on my own. I think there's always these different levels of people that allow us to learn from them. I couldn't have gotten anywhere close to the work that I did in 2009 that was presented here without so many different people helping me along the way. And then to be able to be showcased like that really helped the story to move forward and to be seen. And this will be great, especially now as the exhibitions will be moving around to different locations. I think that's like the best thing that can happen. But it was also really, I'm of course a big lover of Leica, but I'm not a fanboy, but I do believe in the family. and this is something that I attest to, and I think others are as well. And I really got supported from the beginning by Leica and by Karin Kaufmann and Dr. Kaufmann and the whole different teams, including Leica Switzerland. This has been something since then I've been supported, and I've been at Wetzlar so many times and been given a chance to work on projects and be part of different stories. And this is real. Like, this is really something that being part of, and I'm so excited that you guys are also part of that, that belief of telling stories and helping photographers to move to do that is something that I can't imagine that would have, I think it really moved me into a trajectory that got me to sit here now, and I'm really grateful that I can share the stage with two incredible photographers who are defining our time right now and are bringing that new energy that we need and breaking the rules and discussing them and talking about representation. This is something that's really exciting just to be part of. So.
Yeah, I mean, and I think that's something that we were so fortunate as part of the jury to be able to have those conversations. I think that we very consciously were examining who we wanted to kind of put on this pedestal to reflect, like, not only a recognition of the work that you've already done, but also the work that's to be done and going forward in terms of the people that we want to be, you know, encouraging. And I feel so grateful to have been it felt like the jury really was all on the same page in terms of recognizing the value in that.
And I second everything Dominic said about having those mentors and also on top of that, all the editors who take risk to send you, be the first one to give you your first assignment or do all the firsts, also credit to them, honestly.
Yeah, I remember I got it was an Arnaud from GQ France gave me my first magazine assignment where I was on the bike and then I saw the phone call, so I stopped and I almost fell off the bike when he said who he was working for, and then I asked him how he wanted it to look, and he's like, just do your thing. And I remember that going, like, that's incredible. I can just do my thing, and that, like, having that chance to be able to explore a story without having to be told what the story is, that's amazing.
It's so,
and
a privilege.
And as you said, you're now in a space where you're confident, since a while, of course, with your experience, to define also what the story should be and not let other people tell you what it should be. I think that's really cool.
Yeah, it's so wonderful. I think we're actually at time.
Perfect.
But do you have any final thoughts that you want to share?
I think there's a big there's no young photographer there, but there's a big takeaway. It's like, start photographing your own friends. You'll get some.
Look into your community.
Yeah, that's the...
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Do it.
Great.
And apply. Apply to these. Don't be scared. Put yourself out there. It's okay to not be the winner. It's worth it.
Okay. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you.